Okay, ladies and gentlemen, it's a bit of a challenge now to keep your attention on this panel. And believe me, this panel is going to really be the icing on the cake. And I take the liberty of saying, despite the fact that I'm a fan of Sadhguru. So let me get cracking with the first question itself. And Mr. Dixit, I'd like to sort of, since Ms. Hari has had her say in the earlier show, let me reserve your punches for a little later. Let me ask Mr. Dixit the first question. Now, there is a view among some skeptics in India that when we talk about India providing enough energy sources from within, we are not doing enough to encourage exploration and the involvement of energy companies, particularly from overseas. Now, is that view founded on fact or is it fiction? Because equally important is the fact that it takes a bit of heart, and you would know it perhaps better than most of us, to come out and pitch yourself into the wilds of India, as it were, to try and explore new sources of energy. Would you really then say that not enough companies are willing to come forward and make an investment like yours has made, both in time, energy, and people?
Well, I would say that as far as the differentiation, what you're talking about, it does not exist. And actually, an equal platform is available, whether it is a domestic company or whether it is a company from outside. The topic still remains is this exploration and is like mining. And it's not a business of weak heart, I can only say so. We have excelled in this, Vedanta, whether it is natural resource or oil and gas. It is a risky business, and we know how to take that risk and manage it. The topic still remains is how far you can go, how well you engage, and how do you make things possible. As far as the E&P business is concerned, there is a clear need for India to be producing domestically, and we strongly believe that India must produce 50% of its demand. The fact still remains is 70% is unexplored. So I would say we are engaged with the government also. They have come out with more reforms, what they have proposed in the coming exploration, and equal amount of opportunity exists. We have taken our call and gone ahead with the majority. And I would say there is no stoppage for any foreign company in that respect.
So good. So you've cleared the air on that aspect. But I'd like to ask you, sir, that where is it that you find that subsidies work for internal exploration or internal measures or initiative to provide us the next big leap forward in terms of alternate energy? Or do you find that subsidies in itself can be the enemy of this exercise?
So let's divide the question into two parts. First thing you asked about the renewables part, that whether the subsidy will help in initiating or triggering the onset of the renewables to replace or to substantiate part of the fossil fuels. It is a fact that most of the renewable energies are in the initial phases. If you leave aside solar, wind, etc., where some work has been done, but if you go to bioenergies, converting the agri waste, converting the used oil, converting the municipal waste to biogas or bio oil or ethanol, or for that matter the biodiesel, the technologies are in the initial phases. and technologies are not yet developed. And so if we want in a country like India where it is an agri-waste, substantial quantities available, if you want to convert into any means of energy, and because this is a source which is indigenous, rest all the sources are more or less imported. In that case, we need some sort of support to ensure that these technologies are commercialized, these technologies are promoted, it comes to a level where it becomes commercial.
Yeah.
But going to the next stage, whether it can just survive on the basis of the subsidies, it should not. So at some point of time, it should become purely based on the economics and the commercial. That's one part of it as far as the supply part is concerned. But there is a second part of as far as users is concerned of the energy, whether it should be purely subsidiarism. I think we need to come out of a phase where the energy is like any other commodity and it is a usable item. So unless
but
there is...
But it is finite.
It is finite. So the question is, unless it is required for a certain section of the society to bring them above up to a level, to that extent is fine. But to continue providing subsidy to the same sections, same mass, even if they have grown above the threshold level of the economics, I think it will be an unsustainable proposition on the part of any government for that matter and any company also for that matter.
Okay. Ms. Hari, now it sort of automatically leads me to a question that I've been waiting to ask you actually. Now this is pure statistics that I've gathered and I'm not an energy expert like you. They say for a barrel of oil, which has something close to 42 gallons of energy in it, something close to 32 gallons of gasoline and diesel is used for transportation fuels like, you know what I mean, cars, jets, etc., etc. And 10 gallons out of every 42 gallons or thereabout, which is about 22%, goes to make products like plastics, lubricants, etc., etc. So, even alternate energy, which the champions of alternate energy keep pushing, eventually needs oil for a lot of the elements for making alternate energy viable. So is there an alternate to oil for alternate energy?
Very good question. The single biggest challenge, can you hear me? The single biggest challenge that the world is facing today is if you look at the replacement for fossil fuels, so you have to put oil, gas, coal all on one side. These are fossil fuels, these are polluting fuels, gas not as much, but certainly coal and oil. And completely clean fuels, so you have nuclear energy and you have renewables. What we know so far, the technology that is available to the world, renewable fuels cannot grow to occupy all the energy needs of the world that are currently fulfilled by oil and gas. So you're absolutely right. If you look at transportation sector, yes, you can to a certain extent replace it with gas, but renewable energy, again, we have to separate the hype from the reality. Renewable energy, we should be very clear in our minds, solar and wind power is only electricity. And let's face it, we do not have the means, the technology yet for electricity to meet all of our energy needs. So absolutely, oil and gas will be required. The challenge for the world is how to use oil and gas and all the way from the production through the transportation chain, all the way to the user. All parts of that chain have to take responsibility to use it sustainably, to use it economically, to use it in an energy efficient way and to reduce the emissions as far as possible.
Just a quick extension to you to that question is that, you know, even the alternate energy sources, mechanisms, whatever it is, say for instance you look at a windmill or you look at some of the other items like solar paneling, also need a certain amount of oil and gas to be able to make it work. So therefore, we go back to square one, do we?
Yes. So again, as I said in the earlier panel, renewables is not the panacea either. There are implications for the environment of renewables as well. Of how when you clear land to put up solar panels, for instance. So yes, it basically boils down to the fact that we are looking, the not just India, the whole world is looking to diversify the sources. For the foreseeable future, as I see it, and a lot of analysts see it, oil and gas will remain the mainstay of our energy.
Okay, so automatically we come to projections, which Mr. Dixit also talked about. Is the petroleum minister has also projected this whole thing that by 2030 or thereabouts, we're looking at 50% of our requirements being met through internal initiatives, whether through exploration or otherwise. Now, as yet, firstly, what are the figures that you can honestly hand on heart say that are available in India in terms of oil and natural resources to be able to shift our dependence on imports from 77% to 67% and from 67% to 50%? Are we going to get there in terms of the projections that you are willing to make?
You know, it is very difficult to make any, give a figure to that.
But as roughly, broadly.
Yeah, Mr. Dixit also told you that there are large areas which are yet to be explored and there are opportunities. I will put it differently. You know, what Minister also said in his panel was that we are not only going to increase the domestic production of oil and gas, that's one aspect of it, but we are also looking at alternatives like biofuels, he said, that bio-CNG. Mm-hmm. You know, there are figures which I got, actually about that I can give you, certainly, that we have a large potential of about CBG, what we call, you know, compressed biogas. You know, you can convert municipal solid waste and other kind of things, you know, and biomass, etc. And we have a potential of about 60 million tons per annum of the biomass itself. Then biofuels you can convert. Then what she said was renewables. You can always, you know, Minister also touched briefly about hydrogen. I'll tell you that you have the renewables like solar and wind. And you need solar and wind is not available 24/7. So you need to store that. Either you store in the battery form, you know, then you need battery materials, which is itself an issue of getting those kind of materials. But another way is to store it in the form of hydrogen. We all know that electrolysis is a very simple process. There are a lot of developments around that. And if you can store it in the form of hydrogen, you can always use it in the fuel cells. You know, there is an alternative to electric vehicles, which is emerging very fast. So if you use in fuel cells, the energy efficiency is almost double. So I will put it that way, that we have to look at the energy efficiency. That's the world is looking at. We need to look for unexplored areas for increasing domestic oil and gas production. We have to look for biofuels. We have to look for, this kind of things. And there are plenty of sources for producing hydrogen also. You can always do that.
Okay.
And renewables projection is very high. You know that.
Well, let's hope we all keep our fingers crossed and remain optimistic till you strike oil, as it's often used as a phrase. But Mr. Dixit, sir, we spoke earlier and you talked about the fact that oil production can be increased and the fact that your company in particular is really targeting to increase oil production. I mean, that's been your endeavor for maybe 25 years plus minus. How is it, where are the areas in India or in the Indian subcontinent you wish to focus on, and how is it you wish to go about it to make the oil or energy available to us at competitive prices that it allows your economy to invest in that and still grow at the projected rate that it is being, though I'm not entirely sure that we can really look at a galloping figure of $5 trillion economy in the next few years. Maybe eventually we'll get there.
The question, I would say, has three parts.
Yeah.
One, what we are going to do prospectively. Second, what we are going from existing blocks, and third, how to make it viable.
Absolutely.
So we are very committed on this part, I would say, out of the 80-odd blocks which have been tendered, 51 or 53 blocks have been acquired by us, and we are rapidly moving in producing this. In this, really, the major part of it, technology plays it, how fast we discover, and then how fast we convert discovery into production. And just for the sake of audience, I would say the oil and gas business is like you are standing in the middle of a escalator coming down, and if you have to grow, you have to run faster than the speed of the escalator coming down. That is the oil declining, what we call is. So here we have to be faster. It's a business of more and faster. In the existing field, we are employing technologies so that we can recover more oil from the existing oil in place. So a general standard is in the range of about 20, 25, 35%. We have done a research of about close to 6 to 7 years. And due to this new way of chemical injection, we are going to increase the recovery from even the existing producing field to more than 50%. Now, in all this comes is the cost of technology and cost of operations. And on that is also a recovery which we are paying to the government, which is close to today in the producing field in the range of 55 to 60%. So the cost and the recovery, if it becomes more than the Brent, then it is unviable. So there lies the engagement with the government. How do we put a regulatory tax mechanism where we are able to produce more? Because in the end, you save foreign exchange of importing the oil. So a matter of $8 to $10, if you give to double the production, what you save practically is $40 practically, compared to what we are producing.
If I may just quickly quip in and say that, have you attempted to give to the government and the policymakers or the bureaucracy a kind of spreadsheet to say that if this is the route that we follow, at the end of it, it is a win-win situation for all? Are you expecting the oil generalist bureaucrat to calculate that for you?
I would say we are engaging with the government regularly, and I must applaud the existing government because they are open to listening. Okay. The fact remains that the new exploration policies, they have been well discussed with the producing companies, E&P companies, and they have made changes. That has resulted into making it more attractive because it brings into more transparency, and it limits to the extent how the whole taxation and royalty regimes are there, which are world class and global. Okay. The next step, what we are engaging with the government is what has been done and recognized as difficulty and made easier in the new OLP, what we call as HELP policies, to be implemented again in the existing producing field. So we are having an open dialogue, and I must say that if something can happen, it can happen in this government. The government is open, it discusses, it receives the suggestions, and they do take due steps.
Okay, so that's good news for the government and certainly contradicts the pessimism that exists at certain other levels. But Mr. Surana, sir, I want to ask you that, you know, there's this debate that has been going on for more than a decade now, that the world has reached peak oil production, which means that we are now on a downhill slope, having produced or excavated or dug deep in for virtually maximum oil that we could draw from the earth over the last 150 years, and the next maybe 100 years or more would probably see the world going dry of oil. Or are those projections still fluctuating and an overstated alarm?
Actually, this debate is not going on for 10 years. It has been going for much more. To tell you frankly,
I'm told from 2005 onwards.
Okay. See, in fact, when I joined the industry 37 years back, a question was asked to me that why you are joining an oil industry? Oil is there only for 30 years. But I am already 37 years in this industry, and the oil is there, and at least nobody is talking about that it will not be there in next 30 years at least. Actually, every time a projection has been made, it has been made based on the known resources at that point of time, the technology known at that point of time. 10 years back, probably nobody knew about Shell. But it's not that the Shell technology was not there. It was invented much earlier. It has not been commercialized. But once it has been commercialized, it has been considered as a game changer, and now US, who used to import, is exporting. So first thing, that I don't think that the last word is said as far as the fossil fuels or oil and gas is said. There will always be the technology will evolve itself, technology will innovate itself, and there will be new resources and there will be new technology to produce something which is discovered but not produced because it was not economical. That's one part. The second part is that even today, when the people are talking about that it is peaked oil, actually that consumption pattern is going at a certain pace. People are talking about whether the demand will peak or not, considering the other technological disruption which are likely. In today's world, I think the narration is not that whether the supply will peak. And actually right now, the narration is more centered about whether the demand will be there or not there, rather than whether the supply will be there or not there.
Okay. So, Ms. Vandana, I want to understand from you. Now, the projections that are there, which we can go by, which is there in the public domain, in terms of the reserves of oil particularly, these projections have been changing. Sometime in 1983, the reserves were being shown at a certain level. And by 1988, the reserves suddenly began to double up in terms of the major oil producers. I'm talking of the UAE, I'm talking of Iran, I'm also talking of Saudi Arabia. So how is it suddenly over a period of 5 to 8 years, they were able to dig deeper and tell you suddenly that the reserves available to the world are twice the reserves of what were available earlier? Where is the mismatch?
It's no mystery and it's not a mismatch. And I think as Mr. Dixit and Mr. Surana have already alluded to, at any given point of time, what we knew and said about the reserves in any particular country or globally was based on the technology available that day. So it's not about digging deeper. So shale is not about digging deeper. Shale is simply about the world learning how to extract oil that was trapped in small pockets inside rocks, which is completely different geology from the traditional drilling of an oil
well. By using usable water.
So lots of water, lots of sand, and lots of chemicals. So the bottom line here is, and as my fellow panelists have already said, the world is not running out of oil, and technology is one thing which is forever advancing. So I don't think we need to worry about the world going dry anytime soon.
Okay, final shot to you, sir. Where is it that you feel we are going to continue to get the money to fund our growth if a large chunk of our money goes to buy the items which, particularly oil, which is required to fuel our growth?
Where the money is?
Where's the money going to come from if you're spending money to get something to get your economy to grow?
No, I think we have been doing that.
We've been doing that, but that's not a very happy situation.
No, but I
believe it's almost 3.5 to 5% of the GDP goes purely on importing oil and energy. Now, is that the way forward?
No, the two things. One is that we have put in place, the government has put in place the policies, as Mr. Dixit said. There is a hope in policies like HELP, IOR, which is Enhanced Oil Recovery, etc., which are incentivizing the industry for increasing the domestic production. And the second is about renewables, use of renewables, use of alternatives, which we can, coal, bed, methane, etc., and also, using the various other sources, like biogas and, biofuels, etc. These are the kind of things which will certainly help us. And the bioenergy has large potential in a country like ours, which is untapped, which is causing pollution. So I think if we can tap that bioenergy in a systematic manner, the collection of biomass is a problem, but if we can do that, there are plenty of opportunities. And
well, I must thank you all for your wisdom and your inputs. But I think the jury is still out on three issues. One is, what is the level of reserves available to the world to fuel our growth over the next 100 years as compared to what was projected maybe 10 years ago? The second is, are alternate fuels required to fuel your economy when alternate fuel or alternate energy sources in itself require the basic fuel that the world is beginning to run out of, at least that's what many experts believe. And finally, and most importantly, I think we need to go public with the kind of initiatives that have been taking place so that more and more people are educated about how energy and oil are so crucial for our growth, but at the same time, where we can take steps to ensure that that precious reserve, which is only finite, is used to the best advantage. Thank you very much for being with us, and thank you very much for your patience. Good evening. Yeah.
And thank you all for your time, and we request you to please take your seats. Ladies and gentlemen, a round of applause.